Hello, and welcome to segment 2. In our first segment, we met Paul and Jill, two simulation analysts with looming deadlines. Let's join Paul and Jill as they take some critical first steps in organizing their data, based on the updated federal guidance.
All done with your power lunch, Paul?
Refueled and ready. How do I start?
The first step is to think about the project itself. What are the key system performance measures?
The DOT has a goal to improve travel time reliability in the morning commute from West Hills into the central city. The city council is worried that traffic may be hampering economic growth.
Okay. The key performance measure is travel time reliability. What are the alternatives under consideration?
There are two options. The first improves local bottlenecks. A second alternative invests in traveler information and adaptive signal timing. There is only enough money to deploy one option.
Good. However, we need to move beyond an average day approach to model travel time reliability. Here are some notes about how to organize your data. If we think of the network as a system with good and bad days, it makes sense to organize the data around morning peak periods. This technique is specifically called out for reliability projects in the federal guidance.
Makes sense to me.
Let's meet in the lab after you organize your data by morning peak period.
Here's my data. Each row is a morning peak period. On the far left is throughput based on count stations just upstream of key bottlenecks. Next to these, I have travel time data on three inbound routes and reported incidents.
Nice work. What about weather?
I used nearby airport data to characterize weather.
I see you've characterized demand.
One traffic count station is right at the start of the Marine Causeway. It's far enough away from the key bottlenecks that it's never congested, and can serve as a proxy for inbound demand.
It does look like travel demand varies a lot day to day.
Yes. But the other attributes vary as well. This was clear once I organized the data. Fridays are super different, but not all of them are the same. The patterns seem incredibly complex, and dependent on multiple factors.
Great job organizing the data.
Thanks. But the next step is cluster analysis, and that is new for me. What does it do?
Cluster analysis is a statistical method that essentially does just what you've already started to do, find underlying patterns in the data.
That seems very powerful. I know I can't see all the patterns myself.
Exactly. Let me give you some background. Here is some sample data. The cluster analysis software grouped these data into 6 clusters. Cluster analysis seeks to gather together the days that have similar attributes into discrete groups, minimizing the differences among days in the same cluster, and at the same time maximizing differences among days in different clusters.
Radical. But I'm curious. What makes them similar beyond these two attributes?
The days are similar in two ways. First, in system performance with respect to travel time and bottleneck duration. Second, with respect to underlying causes of congestion or delay. Different combinations of travel demand, weather, and incidents create similar travel conditions. Conditions you can model in your traffic simulation.
Wow, that's great. But this cluster analysis must need a supercomputer.
Actually, open source software can conduct cluster analysis on your everyday laptop.
That's amazing. Let's get clustering.
Easy champ. First we need to normalize your data.
Normalize?
Some attributes are numeric, and other attributes are text descriptions, like incident data. The software will put more weight on differences measured in the thousands, like demand or throughput, rather than differences measured in tens and hundreds, like precipitation. For cluster analysis to work well, we'll need all attributes to be numeric, and on a uniform scale. Here is your data after normalization. Note that all attributes are on a scale that ranges from 0 to 1.
Now that the data are normalized, can I get clustered?
Sure. But keep in mind a couple of key points as you proceed, as you put it, to get clustering. First, include many attributes when you start, then narrow down the analysis to the most meaningful attributes.
Okay. Let me take a swing at this, and I'll bring the results down to your office. I know it's going to be awesome.
Making progress?
Preparing the data took some work. But running the cluster analysis software wasn't hard. I got results right away. Then I ran the software multiple times to get a feel for the clusters it proposed.
Exactly. Cluster analysis requires the active engagement of the analyst to understand the patterns found by the software.
That part was cool. But the software kept asking me how many clusters I wanted before it performed the analysis.
It depends on the type of cluster analysis selected. For k-means analysis, you must provide the number of clusters as an input.
Got it. I did use k-means since it was used as an example in the federal guidance.
No worries. There are many good clustering techniques. K-means is a fine choice. It's important to produce a practical number of clusters. The guidance has an equation for the maximum number of clusters to consider. For 100 days, that max is 14 days.
Right. I tested all the options from 3 to 14 clusters.
Did you calculate the two cluster optimization metrics the guidance recommends?
I did. On the x-axis is the number of clusters. The coefficient of variation metric just rose steadily. The comparison of variance metric provided a local minimum at 5 clusters. However, with 14 clusters I got the same low value.
Okay, good work. In this case the comparison of variance is the best differentiator. And, since 5 clusters is a much more practical value than 14, 5 clusters is the best choice.
I was hoping you would say that.
What can you tell me about travel conditions in each of the 5 clusters?
100 days are divvied up into 5 unequal groups. The underlying patterns were unclear at first glance.
A helpful tip in the federal guidance is to examine how the key attributes in each cluster relate to the overall average. Then, look for commonalities and differences in the performance and underlying operational conditions. This will characterize each cluster.
Right. That's what I did. Cluster 1 has the highest precipitation and lowest visibility of all the clusters. Demand was low, and travel time was close to average. I used the same method to characterize each cluster.
Great work. You are ready to get buy-in from our client on your analysis. This is important because we need that before you start calibrating.
Yeah, I really want to shine for our firm, with our client in traffic ops. Hopefully I won't be too nervous.
Paul, don't worry about that. Just relax, and let the data be the star of the show.
Jill, you are the best. I'm so psyched to make a great impression, and blossom into a simulation superstar.